Sir Pleasant, good afternoon to all of you. So we have gathered here for this webinar session on MATLAB applications for civil engineering. So I think most of you are aware that so we have purchased this MATLAB software. So we have got an institutional license for this. And what I'd like to convey here is that our principal wanted us to conduct certificate programs on MATLAB. So when I circulated this brochure to our principal, he suggested that a certificate program should be conducted from the department. And since we have to first get exposed to various tools available in this MATLAB software, so we requested MathWorks to conduct a session exclusively for the Department of Civil Engineering. So based on that, they have accepted our request and they have given a date for us. So I just request all the faculty members present here to just note down the points have been discussed in this webinar. And we have to be ready soon for offering a certificate program for the students of SBCE as well, and also to their students outside also. So we can offer certificate programs for the other college students also. So with that aim only, this program is being organized. So, and students also, please make use of this opportunity, because you can make use of this for your project works also. So some of the MATLAB applications are there in civil engineering. So you, even for your project work, whether it is a design project or your main project work, so you can make use of this MATLAB so that in your project work, at least some part of so this MATLAB application can be included in your project also. So with this brief note, let me hand over the session to Ms. Satya Priya, AP Civil Engineering of our department.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm happy to welcome you all to the webinar on MATLAB in civil engineering. I welcome the speaker of this webinar, Spandana Gonkotla. I welcome Dr. R. Kumuda, ma'am, professor and head of the Department of Civil Engineering, SBCE, and I welcome all the faculties and students of department. This webinar session on MATLAB and civil engineering is especially for department faculties and students as specified by the HOD. I'm sure that you will all get to know MATLAB after attending this webinar. Once again, I welcome you all to the webinar on MATLAB. And now I am delighted to introduce our speaker, Spandana Gonkotla. She is an educational technical evangelist at MathWork India. She works with the faculty and researchers across India to enable effective use of MATLAB and Simulink in their curriculum and research. She specializes in data analytics, mathematical modeling, machine learning, and deep learning workflows using MATLAB. Prior to MathWork, she studied smart actuating systems using mathematical models for her PhD. She graduated with a PhD in chemical and biomolecular engineering from National University of Singapore, and a BTEC in chemical engineering from National Institute of Technology, Karnataka. So further, without any delay, we will hand over the session to the speaker. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Satya Priya. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Spandana, and Satya Priya ma'am very kindly introduced me quite well. So along with me here, I have my colleague, Dr. Anand Mukhopadhyaya. Both of us work for the education team at MathWorks Bangalore, and we support a number of researchers, educationists, students, professors, and so on for their use of MATLAB and Simulink in their research and classes. So I'll hand over the session to Anand now for briefly introducing himself. Over to you, Anand.
Good afternoon. Thanks, Spandana, and good afternoon, everyone. So I am Anand, and my background is from the electronics department. So I have completed and my specialization in the topic VLSI, which is different from this civil engineering. But the good thing about using MATLAB is that it is used by multiple departments in multiple aspects. So it can help us in solving a wide range of problems, which is applicable to different departments. So which we will see how in today's session. So
thank you very much, Sandra. Thank you. So my background is in chemical engineering. Anand is from electronics and specialization is in VLSI. So we both are from very different backgrounds. Our team is composed of people from multiple backgrounds, but unfortunately no one is in civil engineering or graduated from civil engineering. So bear us while we talk a little bit about civil engineering and correct us if we are wrong. And The common thread that connects me, Anand, or anybody on our team with multiple different specializations is the fact that we are all engineers and we have all used MATLAB and we all know mathematics. So the core of any engineering is mathematics, as we all know. So we'll be demonstrating MATLAB today from the mathematics point of view and bear us for all the mistakes that we make from the civil engineering side of things and correct us if we are wrong. Thank you very much. So let me get started. I'll share my screen now. I'll switch off my camera to conserve bandwidth. And if you have any questions in this entire presentation, as and when you have questions, put it in the chat, or you can interrupt me, you can unmute and ask me to pause and raise your question, or you can put it in the chat and Anand will try to address it on the chat live. Alternately, I'll pick it up if there is something that needs to be demonstrated at the end of the presentation.
Another thing I wanted to add, so there is also a raise hand feature here. So instead you want to speak whenever you want, you can raise the hand, then we will pause for that moment to take the query.
So is my screen visible to everyone?
Yes, I can see it.
Yes, ma'am, it's visible.
Okay, thank you. So how many of you here who is attending this presentation, how many of you here are professors? Can you raise your hands? Okay, great. And how many of you, and the remaining all of you, I guess, are students, so you don't need to raise hands. So we have a fair number of students here today, and we have a number of professors here. So let me try to make this session useful for both of you. So today's topic is on modern MATLAB for civil engineering and the five things that you need to know about MATLAB. How many of you here have used MATLAB before? Can you raise your hands? We have one hand up. Anyone else who's used MATLAB before? Okay, so none of you here have used MATLAB. That's interesting to know. So we'll start the session from very introductory level so all of you can get a flavor of what you can do with MATLAB. But before we get started, we'll post a link to the SVCE MATLAB portal. So what is this link? This link will give you access to MATLAB. So if you click on this link and go to sign in with MATLAB part, like this is where your link will take you to. And here you can see sign in to get started. So those of you who have not downloaded or installed MATLAB, you can go to this link and create a MathWorks account. You can go to this sign in to get started. If you don't have a MathWorks account already, you can create one now. But when you're creating the MathWorks account, ensure that you use your university email ID. Your university email ID will automatically enable you access to the license, the MATLAB license. So you can either download MATLAB in your own personal computers, or you can use MATLAB online. So to use MATLAB online also, you'll need your MathWorks account, which is associated with your university email ID. So you can go to matlab.mathworks.com and you can sign in with your university email ID to access MATLAB online. So if there are any users here who want to practice with me what we are doing, or just roughly try it out, you can go to matlab.mathworks.com, open MATLAB online. So this is the browser version of MATLAB. To use this version of MATLAB, you don't need to install MATLAB at all. All you need is a MathWorks account, which is connected to your university email ID. This is how MATLAB online will look like. Okay, how many of you here have MathWorks accounts already? Can you raise your hand? I don't see any hands raised, so I guess none of you have created MathWorks account yet. So I'll give you 5 minutes time. Why don't you click on this link and click on sign in to get started. Create a MathWorks account with your university email ID. Please don't use your personal email IDs. You will not be getting access to MATLAB. Anyone facing any problems? You can unmute and speak.
Spandana, to add to it, you can open that thing in the incognito mode just to show them what are the few information they need to fill to make
okay,
and to
sure.
create that form. Yeah.
So let me do that. So I have posted this link. I'm opening it in incognito. You don't need to. So you'll probably select your country and then. So this is what you'll be able to see. Now go to sign in to get started. So here it'll say to download MATLAB, you must have a MathWorks account created with your university email ID. Here you can put your email ID, whatever it might be. I'm just putting spam.
Or I think they have to click on the create one account because I think they haven't created the
Yeah. So you can go to create account, put your university email ID. I'm going to just put this is not working, by the way, just putting something. Ensure that it is your university email ID. And you can select, if you're a student, you can select student or teacher, whatever it is. Select yes if you're 13 plus. And then once you create that, you'll get a verification email to this particular email ID. So you have to go to that email ID and click on the verification link. Is everyone able to follow me? Please type yes or no in the chat. Okay, great. A lot of you, how many of you have finished this? You've created a MathWorks account. If you've created a MathWorks account, can you write created a MathWorks account or MW account in the chat? Okay, great. So I see that a number of you have created your MathWorks account already. And as soon as you created one, please put it in the chat so I'm able to follow what you're doing. Now, if you have a MathWorks account, you can go to matlab.mathworks.com. And then log in with your, go to this, sign in. And sign in with your email ID that you just, the MathWorks account you just created. Okay, I hope you'll all be able to sign in. Anand, can we put the matlab.mathworks.com link in the chat? I'll just proceed with the presentation now.
Okay, sure, let me do that.
So most of you here have not already heard of MATLAB, but there are few who have used MATLAB in the past, right? MathWorks is a company that is almost in existence for the last 36 years. So MATLAB has evolved over the years, and nowadays the version of MATLAB that exists is not the same as what it was, say, last 5 years or 10 years before. So let me just show you what MATLAB looked like in the past. So the if you've used MATLAB before, you will probably relate to this. So if you had to create an array, it would look something like this. This is how you'll define an array in MATLAB, where you'll write elements in rows separated by commas, and then the columns are separated by semicolons. So this is how you create a matrix in MATLAB. Now, if you want to perform any sort of computation on this matrix, for example, say dividing all the elements in this matrix with, say, for example, one element in this matrix, you'll do some mathematical operations like multiplication, divisions, and any simple computations or plotting and things like that. These are the aspects that MATLAB is useful for. First and foremost, what you need to remember is MATLAB is awesome for matrix problems. And most engineering problems are matrix problems. That is why a lot of engineers really like to work with MATLAB. You don't need to unnecessarily use a lot of for loops or while loops and so on to define each of your elements. It's very simple. You don't say, for example, what you do in this one line of code, if you had to do it in a low-level programming language like C or C++, it would take you a fair amount of coding where you have to access individual elements. You'll have to access individual elements from this and this and probably do your mathematical operation. And that will involve a fair bit of usage of loops. And in MATLAB, all that is avoided because this works on matrices directly. Now, what about plotting? It's also a very good visualization tool. So if you want to plot some figures or you want to create some plots, you can use MATLAB. And the syntax is very simple, as you see. You define your x variables, you define your y variables, and then you just use one line command for plotting. This is how MATLAB looked like, let's say 10 years ago or 12 years ago. A lot of faculty from civil engineering departments, they say they've used MATLAB very long ago and they think it is not appropriate for civil engineering. And they say MATLAB is a programming language and civil engineering students don't like programming. And also MATLAB is difficult to use. This is what we keep hearing from a lot of civil engineers. Then what about what professors say, that they are very busy to teach MATLAB, too much syllabus, probably Excel is more appropriate. My classes involve very simple calculations. Why should I use MATLAB? And we use specialized CAD tools that the industry uses. There might not be any benefit in using MATLAB. And learning is done only when practicing with pen and paper. There isn't just any other way. These are some of the common things that we hear from civil engineering faculty. But let me remind you that today's engineers, knowledge of any programming language is paramount to today's engineering world. Why? Because a lot of engineering processes which are repetitive in nature can all be programmed to make it easier and save time. And for this reason, a lot of engineers nowadays, there's a good focus in learning any programming language. We are not talking about MATLAB here. There is a need for learning any programming language when you graduate as students. Now, let's get to the main questions that we'll be addressing in the webinar today. That is, how does MATLAB enhance the learning experience for my students? This is what professors are asking. How can MATLAB enhance? When I got a phone call from your HOD, this is what the main question was. We want to use MATLAB. How can we use MATLAB to teach our students and enhance the teaching learning experience? The second thing, is MATLAB is just a programming language, and has it changed in the last, over the last many years? Has MATLAB changed a lot? So let me give you a brief overview of what the world looked like in, say, 1999. Bill Clinton was the Prime Minister of President of US at that point, Atal Bihari Vajpayee, the Prime Minister of India, Karunanidhi was serving his second term in Tamil Nadu, and S.M. Krishna, Chief Minister of Karnataka. And MATLAB looked like this. So it had, MATLAB had one section, command window, and in command window you can type any basic commands. You can ignore this particular line. We haven't really typed anything useful here, but you can essentially probably type plots and everything. Although what we are typing here as plots, these are some of the very powerful mathematical functions. We're taking fast Fourier transform, and this happens in just one line of code. So MATLAB is a very powerful language if we see, and we are plotting it on a semi-log plot. Now, not only this, we also had the editor window, right, in the past. So in the editor window, the code looked like this, all in Korean new font, and the if-else statements, there are loops, there are some comments, and there's a lot of code here. Now, in the latest MATLAB, it looks very different. We'll give you an overview of what latest MATLAB looks like. So this is an example of code generation where MATLAB is able to track this particular lane, and we are able to get input from camera and then generate code, which can then be deployed into any hardware. And all this processing can be done by MATLAB. Now, in civil engineering, there might be students who are interested in traffic control, maybe. And if you're looking at data from traffic control, you're getting, let's say, data from multiple cameras that are present at traffic signals, and you want to write some automation algorithms for controlling the traffic. Now, nowadays, you will end up using a lot. There are a lot of techniques that you can do. Maybe something that can be hard-coded, or it could be something in the AI world as well. So all of these products are available in the latest MATLAB. So modern MATLAB, I'll give you a brief overview of what modern MATLAB looks like. But before that, let's see what are the five things that you need to know about the modern MATLAB. So MATLAB window looks like this now. I'll open my MATLAB to talk about this further. Okay, so what is happening here? What exactly is all this on the screen, if you're wondering? So this is the main toolbar of MATLAB. So you have three main tabs: home, plots, and apps. These are the three main tabs. I'm currently in the live editor window. I have opened one live script. What we see here is the live editor window. This is the command window. Workspace, this is where variables are stored. So if I create a variable, like I'm now defining A as 1, for example, what this does is the a variable named A is getting created, and the value of the variable is 1. This semicolon essentially suppresses the output. So if I press enter, you can see all the temporary variables are stored here in the workspace. And this location is our current folder location. So if I'm working with any files, they need to be loaded in the memory. So that is where I'm choosing which files to be loaded. And those are located in my current folder place. So I'm looking at some MATLAB scripts here. So I've loaded all of them in the current folder. So this is how MATLAB looks like. And if your MATLAB is not looking like this, you can change it in the layout. You can go to home. You can choose different types of layout based on whatever is comfortable for you. Either three column layout, that's where workspace comes to the right, command window is bottom, or you can choose default layout, which is what I was using. All right. So overall, this is all you need to know. Current folder, this section, to know whether the files you're loading and the files you're working with have been loaded and so on. That's all. Once you have loaded your files, you will not be looking at this anymore. Next section is this command window. What is the difference between command window and the live editor? Essentially, in command window, the moment you hit the return key or the moment you hit enter, the line gets executed. Okay, so you can type anything, like say I'm going to create a matrix with 9 elements. So I can create rows like this, separate them by columns. All right. I don't put semicolon here, but I press enter. I can see the output immediately. So this is what I just created, this matrix A. Now let me create matrix B. This matrix is going to be a 3:1 matrix with 3 rows and 1 column. This is my matrix B. Now, if you look at the workspace here, you can see both my A and B. If I want to look further, I can double click this. I can look at my matrix A, close this, look at my matrix B. All right. So I've created basic 2 matrices now. And let's say I want to multiply these 2 matrices. And I'm going to create a matrix C. This is the output. So I've been able to multiply A and B. All right. So let's say if I want to multiply them element wise. What is element-wise multiplication? So there are 2 things, right? Dot product and cross product. Cross product is when you are going to have, when you're going to multiply, say, one matrix with another, but there's a stringent condition for the cross product. That is, the number of rows of the second matrix should match the number of columns of the first matrix, all right? That is the condition for enabling your cross product. What is dot product? Dot product is nothing but every element in A is getting multiplied with the corresponding element in B. Like what's happening? One is multiplied with 1, 2 is multiplied with 2, 3 is multiplied with 3. Similarly, 2 is multiplied with 1, 3 is multiplied with 2, and 4 is multiplied with 3. This is dot product that's happening, all right? So we've been able to see how matrix operations can be done in MATLAB. This is fairly simple. All right. Now, what is the disadvantage of using command window? I've been writing all this in command window. Let's say I want to save all of this and I want to revisit this. Can I come back and look at this later? Put your thoughts in the chat. Anand, what do you think? Can I just say do everything in command window itself?
You can do it, but when there are many commands, then and if you want to refer it at a later stage, then it is better to save it in some file.
Thank you, Anand. So this is very difficult, right? Already I'm scrolling so much. You see so much in the command window already. Already I have to keep scrolling so much. But if I want to refer it later on, I'll have to save this somewhere. So instead of that, what we're going to do is, if you want to have your code written somewhere that can be executed, that is when you'll use the live editor. Now, what is live editor? Live editor is essentially a scripting window which contains both text as well as code. So what you see here is, I'm going to maximize this live editor. And what you see here is essentially a bunch of script, all right? We are seeing a bunch of script here. There's some in different fonts. There are images. All these, they're non-executable part of the code, right? They cannot be executed. They're all text format. And then there are lines of code here that are numbered and that come in this blue section. These are executable chunks of code. What is the use of having this non-executable lines of code and executable lines of code? So in olden days, in older versions of MATLAB, you didn't have this option of having non-executable lines of code. And what happens when you don't have that is the code looks a little clunky. You'll have to put a lot of comments. There's no formatting in that. And it's not easy to read. But what is there in Live Editor, it's like rich text formatting. You can do formatting, you can put images. Professors are nowadays teaching their subjects using Live Editors because you can put mathematical equations. This is very, very friendly for teaching. You can change parameters. There are interactive elements in Live Editor. We'll see all that. So how many of you here have been able to open MATLAB in MATLAB Online? How many of you here have opened MATLAB Online? So you can try these lines of code along with me. You don't need to worry about all of this that I have. Just you can start trying out the few lines that we have here. Okay. Now I'm going to the Live Editor tab, and in Live Editor tab, these are the two main.
Hello, Spandana.
I'm there. Sorry. Okay. Now these are the two main. These are the two main things you're going to write. Either you're going to write text or you're going to write code, right? So if I'm in this section where I'm actually writing code, you can see the text button is enabled. So if I want to change to text, I can either click Alt Enter, or if I want to toggle between text and code, I can click Alt Enter. Okay. So if I open a default, like if I open a new live editor by default, if it's enclosed in this gray box, we have code section. Okay, that means you can start writing code here. So I can create variables now, and then I can click on this blue bar here to execute them. This is the output that I'm able to see on the right hand side. So can you all follow along with me? Can you type these, try it out? So what we're going to do is we are going to first clear all the variables in the workspace. So if you saw, we were creating some A, B, C, all those are there. So I'm going to clear all of that. To clear that, I can type the command clear, and I can press on this blue color vertical bar on the left hand side, on the left side of the line number. I click on that and the workspace is now gone. Okay, now let's see how we can assign values. So you'll have to define a variable named alpha and assign this particular value 23.6 to this alpha. So try this out. If you have any questions, please put it in the chat. And if you think I'm going a little fast, you can ask me to slow down. So all of you have finished this? Have you been able to define alpha? type yes or no, Y or N, anything in the chat to interact with me. Otherwise, I have no idea what's happening.
So, Spandana, I saw a couple of hand, I mean, 3 to 4 when you asked the question about
okay.
Who were able to access MATLAB online. So, I'm not sure whether everyone is able to access it. So, for those who are accessing it, are you able to type the first two lines clear and defining the constant? You can type a Y, or if you're facing difficulty, you can type a no or unmute yourself. We will be happy to address that.
Okay, I'm assuming that all of you are able to do it. So let's move on. So if you want to now do some fairly large, let's say, computation, like this kind of equation. Now, this is a really large equation, right? What all exists in this? There are some numeric values like 3, 7, square root of 997, sine trigonometric computation. Then there's some basic arithmetics that's going on here. And then there's this alpha. This alpha value, however, we've defined already. Alpha is 23.6. So if you have some equation like this fairly long, you can still use MATLAB to do it, but you'll have to structure it properly or put all the square brackets properly and so on. How do you write this kind of equation? You'll have to write it as write it here like this. It's very simple. So pi is already MATLAB knows pi is a symbol in MATLAB, so you can just write pi, pi. Square root function is defined as sqrt. So if you want to take square root, you can directly write sqrt of 997. And if you want to square something, like say here 6 square, you have to do this. You're going to use this. It's known as x root, I think, this particular operator. It's available if you type shift and 6 both together, you will find this. So this is how you will write a fairly large mathematical equation. Okay. Now, if you want to add a comment in MATLAB, what do we mean by comment? Comment is essentially that section of code which will not be executed. So MATLAB knows already that this part of line we should not execute it. It doesn't mean anything. You can write any gibberish there. You can write anything useful to you, but MATLAB for the programming language, it doesn't concern that. So how do we write something like that? And what is the usefulness of writing something like that? So here, for example, we are defining y is equal to pi by 2, and we are putting in a comment here. Comment here is, so we have half of pi. It's a small comment. So if you write just this in MATLAB without this symbol, percentage symbol, you'll get an error. Why? In MATLAB language, this is not understood. They don't know what is this in MATLAB language. So if you put a percentage sign preceding the line, that means MATLAB will ignore it. It'll know that this is nothing to do with MATLAB language. It's just ignored. All right. And what about these variables? What type of variables do you have to declare? Are there any rules to declare these variables? If you are familiar with any programming languages, even C, C++, or any programming languages, what we are doing here, it's known as assignment. That means you're assigning a value to a variable. And there are certain rules you have to follow to choose your variable names. For example, can I assign 1 is equal to 2? Like I can take 1 is a variable name, 2 is the value I want to assign to that variable name. That is not allowed. In programming languages, you cannot use a numeric. Only numeric cannot be used as a variable name. You can use any letters and you can use any variables. You can use numeric and a character in combination. But again, it should always start with a character. You cannot start with numerics. You can't write 1A is equal to, say, any vector or any matrix. It won't work. You can't write that. You have to, A1 will work, 1A will not work. It cannot precede with a number. It can only come after a character. All right, there are some rules. You can look at that. If you want to know more about it, there are some courses. You can take all those courses to learn more. You can always use this particular special symbol. This is a special symbol in MATLAB. Underscore, which is a special symbol. You can use a number of underscores. MATLAB will accept only underscore as a special symbol. You cannot use asterisk. You cannot use any other special symbols like exclamatory marks and so on. All those are not understood. So there are some specific rules you need to follow to pick the variable name. Now we are getting a question, how to check availability of a global formula or value of symbol in MathWorks like pi, sine, a sine or sine inverse and so on. You can go to the documentation page. There's a help section here and then you can check that. You can, let's say I'm going to type pi here and my documentation opens up here. I'm getting another window that opened up. And it will automatically start looking for what I put here. So you can see here, pi is defined as a function in MATLAB. And it is defined in this mathematics. In elementary math, there are constants and test matrices. And in that, pi is already defined. So there are a lot of things that are defined, like pi. You can see what all are defined already. Also trigonometric functions like sine, cosine and so on, they're also all defined here. And what is the input of the trigonometric function sine? Is it taking an input argument in degrees or radians? All that is available here. So you will have to read the documentation to proceed. So if I write sine of 90, will MATLAB understand, is that 90 degrees or are we looking at sine pi by 2? So MATLAB can understand only in radians. So you'll find that information in the documentation section. All right.
So to add to this, Sandhana, I have posted one link where it is basically the documentation of different Greek letters and special characters that can be used during when they're plotting and other scenarios as well.
So. Okay, now let's get to the demo for today. I think this is a concept that all of you might have studied, how to build retaining walls and calculate the stability of retaining walls. Students here, are you all familiar with this concept? Please type a yes or no in the chat. I hope all of you are paying attention. I know it's lunchtime and it's just post lunch. So I hope none of you are falling asleep. We are hearing from very few students. Some of them say yes and some of them say no. They haven't heard about retaining wall concept. So I'll try my best to explain it and pardon me if there's something wrong. Any of the faculty members, please feel free to chip in if you want to add something. So essentially, what is a retaining wall? In my understanding, a retaining wall is a wall which is built to retain, say if you have soil here and you want to stop the soil from flowing across to different side of your land or something of that sort, engineers build a retaining wall. All right, so now what is this retaining wall? There are some dimensions for this retaining wall. That is, what is the thickness of the retaining wall and what is the height of the retaining wall and so on, all these other dimensions. Now depending on the amount of soil you have, that is h, the size, the value h here, you will have to calculate the dimensions of the retaining wall that you need to build. Now what are the calculations that are involved here. They're all very simple if you see. They're all algebraic, I mean, not even algebraic, it's all arithmetics, basically. You're essentially going to calculate some moments. There are two important moments. One is known as the overturning moment. And the second one is known as the resisting moment. Essentially, this soil here is applying some pressure on this wall, right? This pressure is known as lateral pressure. Lateral pressure, why lateral? Because it's applying in horizontal direction. The soil is applying pressure in this horizontal direction, all right? And now we are going to see the moment or force times the distance of the pressure that is being applied by the soil, whether it is capable of overturning this retaining wall. What is the resisting moment? The resisting moment is the weight of the wall itself. Weight of the wall, thickness of the wall contributes to the resisting moment. Now, where does the resisting moment arise from? There's a this given component of weight, and this weight is acting vertically downwards. And this is, if we assume this as the point of or fulcrum, so if the wall were to topple, it will topple along this point. So we are going to consider all our dimensions from this point here, and we are going to see whether these two moments can balance each other. Now, what defines, I mean, what, based on what will you choose your wall dimensions? What are the factors that will affect your wall dimensions? Can those of you who are putting yes in the chat, can you answer this? What all are the factors that will impact your output? That is, how will you design this wall, this retaining wall? What are the factors that you'll need to keep in mind for designing this wall? See, there's no wrong marks here. Please type anything, anything that you think. There's nobody is judging you. There's no marks at all for any of this for answering right or wrong. Feel free to chip in. Soil capacity, great. Seepage of water, mm-hmm. Go on. What are the factors that will influence your design? Water pressure. Wall thickness, weight of wall, character of soil. That's great. Harishwaran has given a lot of input and I think hits the nail on the head. So what all, there's a self weight of wall, then there's character of soil, what type of soil it is. Is it clay or is it sand, and density of soil, water pressure, there's center of gravity of the wall itself and the height of the wall. These are all going to decide what will happen, whether the wall is stable or unstable, all right? I think we've gotten our answer. So now let's see what are the moments here. So if you essentially, I think you would have taken the classes, you know how to calculate moments. If you see the center of gravity for the soil, essentially you're looking at a triangle. So the center of the moment here would be essentially based on this particular force here, the lateral pressure. For the force contributed by the lateral pressure times the distance, which is h by 3. Now, if you have to further define what the force is, what is the definition of P, it is given based on multiple things like gamma, which is soil coefficient. Here, we'll just write it as G. And then there is unit weight of soil. These are all characteristics of the soil itself. So it depends. For different types of soil, you have different gamma and G and so on. Now, what is the resisting moment? The resisting moment comes from the self weight of the wall itself and the distance from the fulcrum or this point A. So that is W times X. Now, further, if we can, now we'll look at how we are going to calculate this or do this basic calculation in MATLAB. So you know all these parameters. Let's assume that you know the wall you're going to build. What is the typical weight per unit length? That's nothing but the density, right? Like sort of like density, it's not exactly density, so don't take my word for it. Then there is these particular characteristics we were talking about. Unit weight of soil, this is important. This is the characteristics of soil. Then we have X distance, that is from the point A. And the soil type. The soil type, let's choose it from the drop-down menu. Let's take clay first. Clay soil type. Now, G, the value of G is different for different types of soil types. So it's 0.1 for clay and 0.2 for sand. So when I choose clay here, I'm essentially like choosing a string clay, and I have to define what is G for this particular soil type. So how do you do that? In MATLAB, you can use if-else statements. So how do you define if-else statements? So we are saying if the soil type or this string clay is equal to the soil type. We are essentially comparing these two, logical comparison. That's why you see double equal to sign here. Why do we need double equal to sign here and not a single equal to sign? Because you observe all of these, all the assignment operations happen with a single equal to sign. So if you're going to use a single equal to sign, it'll become an assignment operation inside an if statement, which is going to serve no purpose, or rather the output of that will just be true for anything, whether clay is the soil type or not. It's just going to be true because you're actually doing an assignment. You're not doing a comparison. So you're actually, if you want to do logical comparison, you'll have to use double equal to sign. You can check for all the logical operators within MATLAB in the documentation. So you can see here logical operators. Not these ones. These are all in Simulink. So let's see in MATLAB. There are logical operators such as and, equal to, and so on. There are various expressions that one can write. For not equal to, you will write an exclamatory mark and equal to. So if you write it like this, it becomes a not equal to. If you write it like this, it becomes an equal to. Oh, sorry, not an exclamatory mark. You'll write the tilde operator for not equal to. All right, so you can design your own logic. Now the logic is I have to give the G value 0.1 if it is clay, or give the G value 0.2. So for that, what we are going to do is we are going to check inside an if statement if this is true. That means the value of soil type and this particular string clay match, then G value will be 0.1. Else if it is sand, then the G value will be 0.2. If it is neither, then give an error. All right, so this is the logic that we're applying. Now we've already chosen soil type as clay. Now we'll define the height as well. And now let's see if the retaining wall with this dimension, H is equal to 3, is stable or not for this particular soil type. So if you want to see what's happening as the output and you're not able to see anything here, you can always go here and see. See, G value is defined as 0.1. Why? Because we have chosen clay, right? So now let's calculate the two moments, the overturning moment and the resisting moment. So this is the overturning moment given by G, small g times capital G into H squared. If we calculate this, we have an output that is 16.2. Now, what is the overturning moment and the resisting moment? Let's calculate. We have overturning moment of 16.2 and the resisting moment of 25.2. So what do you think is the answer? Is this wall stable or unstable? Put it in the chat. Thank you, Hariswaran, Vijay, Vignesh. Thank you very much. They say wall is stable. Why? Why? Because the overturning moment is smaller than the resisting moment. The weight of the wall contributes to a larger moment, that is 25.2. As opposed, the weight and the thickness, the properties of the wall contribute to a larger moment than the overturning moment. Soil cannot apply more pressure more than the resisting moment, smaller than resisting moment. So the wall is actually stable. Now, how do we implement this logic? We have this logic now. If the overturning moment is greater than the resisting moment, wall is not stable. Else, the wall is stable. How do we apply that logic? We can just write same thing that we did, if, else, if statements, right? So if overturning moment is greater than the resisting moment, you can define that stability of wall is false. And then display an output that wall is not stable. Alternately, just else. You don't need to define what else. If not this condition, then there's only another condition, that is wall is stable. That's also. You can now write this wall is stable becomes true and print that wall is stable. So this is the output. We have a logical output. When we say false and true, for example, does MATLAB know what is true and false? Yes. So these two are actually keywords. So MATLAB by default, it knows what is true and what is false. All right, it'll automatically take them as logical inputs. So we got an output, wall is stable. Now let's see what happens if we are going to keep the dimensions of the wall same, but we're going to change the soil type. We are going to change it to clay now. Sand now. And we'll execute this. Now the wall dimensions, everything will be the same, but we are only going to change the soil type. Now you should see that the G value has changed. G value has become 0.2 now. And then now we got P as 32.4. Let's calculate the overturning moment and the resisting moment. What happens here? Is this wall stable or unstable? Unstable. Why? The overturning moment is greater than the resisting moment. So if we execute this line of code, you can get the output, that is wall is not stable. So we have done some form of stability analysis with the given parameters in MATLAB. All right. Now, how can you increase the stability of this wall for sand as the soil type? Now we know that the overturning moment is greater. So how can you make the wall more stable? By increasing the wall dimensions, that's correct. So what are the dimensions of the wall here? So I think one biggest dimension is thickness. We can see because our moments are also dependent on that, right? X value is our resisting moment is dependent on the X value. So you can see it's W times X. Either you can change the W or you can change the X, then you'll be able to increase the stability of this wall. All right. So by increasing the thickness at base, or you can increase the self weight of the wall. That's great. Thank you. We've gotten all the answers. We've sort of done a basic analysis of this. And this is a very simple live script. All we've used is if else statements, and we've done some basic computations. How many of you now feel comfortable to use MATLAB? Raise your hands. Okay, that's awesome. Any students? Anyone? Okay, now let's see what will make it interesting, more interesting for students to pick up MATLAB. So this was one very simple demo where we saw how to use MATLAB. Now let me go back to the presentation. So we saw how modern day MATLAB looks like, right? So you saw that there's a current folder, there's workspace, command window, all of this. And you can also, there's even more, like if you're working with GitHub and so on, you have Git integration, you can directly plot data. We'll see how that can be done. You can, I'll show you one demo on how to plot data and then do some curve fitting and so on as well. Now, we saw this very nice interactive desktop today. Let's explore a little bit more about this interactive desktop. Now, many of the students here, many of the faculty, you're probably in charge of labs, and students do experiments in the lab, and they're probably working with Excel sheets, they're working with reporting tools, and so on. Let's see how you can do all of that in MATLAB now. This is one simple example we're going to take. This example is based on this particular exercise. So what exercise this is? This is an exercise for soil water measurements. Do you have something like this in your lab as well, where you sort of see how the soil can absorb water perhaps, and then you work with equations and then you do parameter fitting? Are all these a part of your labs? Do you do any exercise or any lab experiment that looks like this? Okay, that's great, Professor Santosh. Thank you very much. So we are hearing that you are using something like this. That's great to know. So in this particular example, what we are going to do is we are having a data sheet. Okay, let's assume that you've already done the experiment and you've collected data. This data is in an Excel sheet, and this Excel sheet, you have to read it into MATLAB and then only you can plot it, right? So many of you might be thinking about, or you might be doing experiments which involve a lot of data collection, and you collect this data, put it in Excel sheet, do some manipulations, plots, and then you'll probably present it in your lab notebook, I believe. So let's see how we can do all of that in MATLAB. So what I'm going to show you now is a virtual lab notebook, which will look like this. So I've created a rough, very rough template. I don't exactly know what the theory behind this is. So let's just keep it as some data that is in the Excel sheet. And this is some experiment. I'm sure all of you know about this experiment more than I do. So let's just assume that there is some experiment. We are going to create a virtual lab notebook today. And this virtual lab notebook can be shared with your professors. It can be shared as your project documents. It can be shared directly if you want to later on, like print this into a PDF, you can do that. So we'll see how we can use MATLAB to do all of this. So many of you are perhaps using your lab notebooks, which is a physical copy. Now let's see how in the pandemic time you can work with virtual lab notebooks. So what I'm going to do here is I have all the data in this Excel sheet here. So let me explore this data outside MATLAB. I right click and then go to open outside MATLAB. So I'll be able to open an Excel sheet which has some data. All right, what data do we have? We have data for pressure, that is psi. The units of this is in kilopascal. And then we have data for theta. This is the y, okay? We have x data and then we have y data. And this data needs to be presented in your virtual lab notebook, and it needs to be plotted, and you need to do parameter estimation as well. You need to fit a curve and you have to estimate some parameters from that curve. So how can you do all of this in MATLAB today? I'll close this. And I'm going to read this data into MATLAB. But before that, I'm going to clear all the variables that are present in my workspace using clear all in the command window. And then I'm going to clear the command window as well. That is CLC. You want to clear the command window. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to import this data. So I can just right click, go to import data. Now an import wizard opens. In this import wizard, just like the Excel sheet, I can see all the data that is present here. I've selected all of that. And then I'm going to import it in the format of a column vector. Why I'm doing this, you'll understand this little later. It becomes easier to plot if it is in a column vector. And you can do some basic pre-processing. Like in case your Excel sheet has any data that cannot be read, like blank cells, or if it has some values like infinity or text or anything of that sort, MATLAB can do some basic pre-processing to remove all of that. All right. And then we are going to just import data. Now, what happens? The moment I click import data, can you observe the workspace? We've gotten this particular data as a vector, right? We've gotten 16.1 theta and psi. Both of them have now come into my workspace. Now I can close this. All right, so now I've been able to import the data. Alternately, let me go back to that import wizard. You can also write a MATLAB code to import this data. How will that look like? You can go to import data and then go to generate live script. So this is all the code that you will need to generate your live script. So you can either copy paste this code if you want within your lab notebook as well. Why would that be necessary? I imported this sheet manually now, but if you're going to say submit this live script to your professor, then you'll have to show that, or they'll have to also be able to import data, right? So you'll have to actually share or generate this live script so that your professor is also able to import data just like how you did. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to copy all of this. It has a lot of lines of code. I haven't written any of these, if you observe, right? We haven't written manually. We've been able to copy everything just as it is. And MATLAB will write this code for us. So just see how easy it is to work with MATLAB in this demo, all right? We are not writing much code at all. Everything is just point and click. So I'm going to import data. I'm putting it in the experimental data section. So this is how I think every lab notebook is structured, or how Anand's and mine were structured. Like how AM, some theory, some procedure, experimental data. I want to show that this is my experimental data for my professor. So I'm going to go to code and then put all this code here. So now I have my MATLAB code within. So all the Excel sheet is now inside my MATLAB, all right? Then I'm just picking up all the code there is. Okay. So this section, now I have actually created both my theta and my PSI, both. So if I want to present it as the output for my professor to see what the two data that I've collected should look like, you can remove this semicolon as well. Or alternately, you can also display it in a table format, all right? So you can, what I'll do is I'll just, I'll just show the output of the table here. So you can see what the data looks like. I'm going to run this code. Now you can see my Excel sheet has now come inside MATLAB. You can scroll this to explore. Now this is the output. Now we have to do some analysis on this now, and we have to plot all of this as well. So now in my results and discussion section, I'm going to create a plot. So let me just put a subsection called plots, and then I want to create this plot. So how do I create a plot? To create a plot, I need these two. Just give me a moment. I'll just clear all the variables and then execute this one last time. Yep, we are done. Okay, we are done. Okay, so for the plotting section, what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a section break here. Why are we creating a section break? Because we don't want to keep loading this data again and again. If I'm going to run this entire piece of code, we'll again start from reading from Excel sheets and so on. I don't want to do it at every time. So I'll just leave this section as it is, and I'm just going to execute the plot section anymore. So I'll leave it as it is. So now we want to plot this pressure versus theta, right? In MATLAB, you plot x, y. So you need to select x value first. So what is x value here? You'll get that information if you go to your equation here. You'll find out what is the y-axis, what is the x-axis. So the y-axis here is theta. The x-axis, the x here is in psi. So x comma y, we are going to select it in that order and then go to the plots tab. There are various plots that are available, and all these are point and click if you observe. So what type of plot you want to choose? If you are going to just choose a standard plot, I've picked a standard plot. This is how it looks like. This is a line plot. Now you see it has very less information. You can't see the experimental data points as such and so on. Now let's see the scatter plot. Scatter plot pulls up all the data points. So here you can see all the data points, but again, a lot of information is lost here. Almost looks like first half of the experiment are all in almost x is equal to zero. So this type of plot is not giving us very good information. We need to be able to space out this data, right? We need to have this x-axis in a logarithmic scale. That means this becomes a semi-log plot, and the logarithmic scale is in the x-axis. So if you want to plot that type of plot, how do we do that? So in MATLAB, you can choose semi-log x as a line plot. Here you see MATLAB line plot, semi-log x. So I'm able to choose that, and this is the output I get. So this is the semi-log x plot I've been able to choose. Okay, this looks good. If you want to do any further additions to this, like say adding title for this plot, adding the x-axis and the y-axis, all of this, you can open the property inspector. In the property inspector, by clicking here, okay, this small window here, you can choose a lot of things. So I'll go to the labels, and in label, I can select the title of the plot. You see a title bar appeared. I can choose the title as say soil water measurement and or any appropriate title. And then we are going to go back to the property inspector, and I'm going to choose now an x label. I'm going to put a x label. This x label will contain, this was psi, right? So I'm going to put this value psi. The units are in kilopascal. And similarly, just click on this y-axis and then go change the y-label. Y-label now is theta. Theta is an angle, I suppose, or in normalized theta. So I'm not going to explain further. So I've now put in the x-axis label, y-axis label, and so on. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to generate code. I have not written one line of code so far. I've been working with a graphical user interface, and I'll generate code. And now you can see we've automatically generated code for creating this particular figure. All right. So you can copy all of this and put it in the plot section. I'm going back to my lab notebook template, and I'll put all this there. So now let's see if we can run this. We'll get an output right here. Okay, so here it says, let's see, axis semi-log x. Okay, we have to define what is this x and y here. So the x is psi underscore APA. And then the y is theta n. So we are going to just define that. All right, so let's try to run this. So you see the same plot here. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to also create some experimental points that we had. Instead of the line plot, I think it's better to have a scatter plot. So I'm choosing some values here. Essentially what I'm saying is I want to specify the ticks. So you'll see what happens if I run this again. Essentially, I want them as circles. That's why this O. And then I want them as blue circles. That's why this B. So how do you know that you have to do all of this? Like, how do you know you have to, you can change properties like this? Go to the plot section in help. And there's a lot of documentation for how you can generate plots in MATLAB. So there are... If you just go to any plot section, you'll see these are the syntax for it. Plot x comma y and then the line spec. So you can decide a little more further what are the line specs. You can choose the line styles. You can choose the marker styles and so on. It's very simple, but you'll need little practice to get here. All right. To get practice, you can go to individual sections and you can practice as well. You can open this live script. It will open directly in MATLAB Online. You can practice, try to understand what's happening in all these lines of code, observe, and then you can learn by yourself as well. All right. So now we have this. Now, what is the next step? We have this particular equation, log of E plus psi by A to the power N. And this whole thing power m. So what are the parameters in this? We have experimental data for theta and psi. We don't have information pertaining to e. E is a constant. That is the value of e, 2.7 something. And we don't know what is a. We don't know what is n. We don't know what is m. But if we want to fit a curve to this data points you have, if we want to fit this semi-log curve, you'll need to approximate the correct value of a, n, and m. This process is known as curve fitting in MATLAB. It's also in mathematics, it's known as parameter estimation. So you have some data points, and how are those two data points related to each other? You'll get this information. This equation is from the literature, and you'll have to. It could be as simple as line fitting. I suppose many of you have fit lines. Y is equal to mx plus c. What are the parameters in lines? Anyone can guess what are the parameters? Try to answer. If you're going to fit a line to any data points you have, you're going to fit y is equal to mx plus c, right? Here we are fitting y is equal to little complex function of x time plus some constants. But if you're fitting a line, it'll be y is equal to mx plus c. What is the parameters in the line fit? Go ahead, answer anyone. What are the parameters in a line if you're going to fit an equation of line? Slope and constant. That is very good. So what is slope? And the constant mx plus c, m and c are the parameters in the line fit. Like that, we have parameters here, which is a, n, and m. So it becomes a slightly difficult equation to fit. That is where you cannot use your graph paper and pencil, right, to estimate so many parameters. If you go on to do even complex problems, maybe in your master's or your PhD, if you go on to work with even complex problems, sometimes you'll be working with differential equations which have parameters. You could be working with different types of equations, extremely nonlinear equations with parameters like this kind of equations and so on. You'll have to resort to other methods like optimization techniques to estimate the parameters. That is what exactly we are going to do. But it's very simple in MATLAB to estimate parameters. So now let's do the parameter estimation part. So I'm going to generate another. I'm going to just do parameter estimation now. And for this, we are going to use a tool known as curve fitting tool. There's an app for that in MATLAB. It's very simple to get started. First, I need to choose, or it's okay. We can just go to apps, go to the curve fitting tool. And here I already have a session that's open. I'm going to just close that. So if you go to the curve fitting tool, this is a blank curve fitting tool. You'll have to choose what is your x data and y data to do the curve fitting. So what is my x here? X is psi. What is y? Y is theta. And you can choose various methods to fit. All those are available within MATLAB. This is our experimental data. This is not plotted in the log semi-log scale. So that's why you're seeing a slightly different plot than what we saw before. That's fine. That's totally fine. But what type of functions, if you're going to fit a line, is this fitting well? Is this a good fit? It's not a good fit. How do you estimate whether it's a good fit? At least the curve that you're fitting should pass through all your experimental data points. The method, like the R square value here, will indicate whether it's a good fit or not. Here, what we have is an R square value, which is very bad, 0.17. What is very good? As close to one, it is very good. Okay, 0.99, 0.97, those are good fits. What happens if we choose different type of fit? Like say here we have, we have some Gaussian fit. It will definitely not fit. Exponential fit, it's exponentially decaying, this one. But let's try this. Not fitting. Because you see, what is the function we are trying to fit? F of x is equal to a e to the power bx. So this doesn't fit well. Now, we already have a function, right? We already know that we want to fit this particular function. So that function is a very special case. It's not lying in any typical functions, like linear fit, or it's not lying in power fit or Gaussian fit. These are typical functions. It's not there. So what we're going to do is we're going to create a custom fit. So you can define our own equation. It doesn't exist already in MATLAB library, but you can define our own equation. Here we are fitting y as a function of x. The custom function can look something like this: a e power b and b to the power x plus c. And then MATLAB will automatically pick which are the parameters. Anything that is not x here is taken as a parameter. So what I'm doing now is, yes?
I was just wondering, when you chose exponential, so can you go back to that one?
Yeah.
So here the second option. So here, if we increase the number of terms, then what could be the effect?
Yeah, if we increase the number of terms, it looks like it's fitting. The R square looks good, but it's not the right fit.
Right. So yeah. We have a different equation with an extra term now.
Yeah. Exactly. So you see here, previously, if we had just x e to the number of terms as 1, we had just a e to the power bx. If we have two terms, a e to the power bx plus c e to the power dx. So there are four parameters that MATLAB has been able to estimate for this fit. All right. And the R square value looks good. But again, is this the right fit for this equation? How can you say that? What is the best fit for a given equation? This is essentially a model, right? This is a mathematical model that is representing your experimental data. what is the best model there is? The best model is the model which has the least number of parameters. So here we have four parameters, but from this particular model, we have just three parameters, that is A, M, and N. So let's try to do this once. We'll just go to custom equation. We'll try to write our own equation. Save time, I've just written already. This E is a constant, it is 2.718. And then psi is nothing but x here because we are writing y is equal to f of x. So x divided by a, this one to the power m and the whole thing to the power m, n and m respectively. So we have done that and then I've selected auto fit. So it already fit for me. The line looks good. You can see the values of a, m and n. I hope it's visible to everybody. Is this all visible to everyone? Okay, so this is the...
I can see it, yeah.
Yeah, this is the value of A, M, and N. This is the output. This is the curve fit output for us. All right. So we've been able to do the fit. Now, what is the next step? You can either save this fit. You can save this session, save the fit. Or we can generate code for this curve fit directly. So this code is in a function type. So we can... we can put this function in our MATLAB script itself, and you can call this function as well. How do we call the function? You can, to call the function, you'll have to just do this. You have to call the function name, pass inputs. For us, inputs are the x variable, y variable, and here the outputs are the fit result, that is, We'll see how this works. So I'm going to run this. Ah, sorry, I think we didn't copy end here. So let's try to run this again. This one, fit result. Okay, so here we are getting our answer. Fit result is essentially we are fitting this function f of x is equal to 1 over log e plus x by a blah, the long equation that we just showed in this live script. And then we are getting the coefficients a, m, and n. This is our final answer. Now we have a mathematical model which can represent our experimental data, all right? Now, if you want to do any regression, like if you know the value of x, you know the pressure, for example, how can you estimate theta? This is known as regression. If you know any value, you can estimate the value of theta using this mathematical model. Now, we have sort of concluded, we've finished doing this curve fitting. You can write some conclusion. The conclusion could be your values of a... You can display the output of your A and M and N as the output. I'm just going to put this as it is. Just create a function break here. Section break, sorry. Okay, let's just leave it as it is. I think the output is already there in the fit result. We don't need to display this. You can type in your own conclusion from your answers, like this experiment, whatever you learned. The final answers and so on. You can type in here and you can also create a PDF of this document I mentioned. So let me just show you how you can do that. You can go to save and save as, not save, sorry. You can go to export and you can directly export to Word or PDF. I'll just go to PDF. You can do it with Word also if you want to do further formatting. and we'll save it somewhere in let's see, my desktop only, it's already cluttered. Okay. Let's see how that PDF would look like. So this is my lab manual, lab notebook that we just created. We have our experimental data, the outputs, then the results and discussion, the experimental data presented, the curve fitting that we did, everything in one place. And the formatting is so neat and so nice, right? Very easy to read. You don't need to put page numbers. You don't need to do all this that you would otherwise in MATLAB, in Word or any of the formatting and things like that. So this is one way you can use your live scripts. They are very useful, and you can not only work with the current experiments that you're doing, all the visualization aspects, the curve fitting aspects, you can work with all of that in MATLAB directly. All right. Now let's go back to our presentation. I hope you've enjoyed whatever we saw, the few demos that we did. So this MATLAB live script, very nice interactive desktop that gives you flexibility for formatting as well. This is the number one thing that is very nice about MATLAB. It's very useful for teachers for teaching. There are interactive controls like the drop-down menu you saw. There are sliders if you want to change parameters and show how the impact of a parameter is on output. And these are all live demos. That's why it's called live script. It's not like a dead document, right? I'm sorry for the alliteration. Anyway, current folder where you can keep your variables, the workspace, then there's this plotting and apps and all of that that is available. We explored the curve fitting app today. In addition, there are so many apps like classification learner app where you can directly, all interactively, you can work with models, you can train your models. We have actually not written any lines of code, if you observed in the second one. We were just working with apps, and then we generated code, and then we copy pasted that code. So we actually didn't write any code. So you can directly export models, or you can generate code like what we saw today. The live editor looks very nice for teaching and for reporting purposes. And the function library, there are a lot of functions in MATLAB. We saw semi-log function today. We saw square root, pi, all these. There are so many functions. Not only this, we have in the AI space also, there are so many functions like training data, testing data, partitioning data, a lot of it actually. If you want to understand more, you can go to the help browser and you can look at MATLAB help to see what are the various functions that are available in MATLAB. So in this video, you can see the help button is there here, and you can access our MATLAB documentation from there, and you can also explore all that is there in MATLAB. So MATLAB as a language itself, the fundamentals of the language, and how to import export data, or how to generally work with any mathematical function. For example, here, how to calculate roots of polynomials, or any other function that you might be working with. All right. So I hope it is quite clear how to use MATLAB. Now, how do you get started to work with MATLAB? So there are a lot of resources for you to get started. Within MATLAB here, you can see a Learn MATLAB toolbar. And that Learn MATLAB will take you to our training page. So at SVC, all students, faculty, everybody that has a university email ID can get access to MATLAB Academy. And what is there inside MATLAB Academy? Lot of resources. I'll come to that. What all is there inside MATLAB Academy? You can see a simple initial training known as MATLAB OnRamp. It will give you a short training on how to use the MATLAB desktop, how to plot, how to script, and so on. And that's very short. It's just 2 hours. And the format of the training is it has some notes, it has some videos, it has an interactive desktop. You don't even need to have have any installation of MATLAB to access that training. You can directly, you get a MATLAB IDE, you'll have to complete certain tasks to get access to, to explore MATLAB on the training page itself. Now, what do we expect in 2021, in the current era, what do we expect civil engineering students to work with in MATLAB? So what we saw today, right, there are a number of experiments that you can prototype, you can try it out in MATLAB. And MATLAB is going from a technical computing environment to an environment which is very useful for teaching engineering concepts. And eventually, for students to solve these engineering problems. And throughout your 4 years, you can use MATLAB for various things, like say soil characterization, or for structural dynamics and so on. So we have, we saw one example of this, right? Soil characterization. What did we see? Data import, visualization, capturing this entire thought process, using help and so on. And for structural dynamics, we have a library of numerical methods like Runge-Kutta solvers. They're all inbuilt and you can directly make use of those solvers. You can solve structural dynamic problems on your on MATLAB in few lines of code. All the computational tasks are made fairly easy. We saw this example of the retaining wall in a live script. Now, I'll show some resources for where you can get access to help if you are new user getting started with MATLAB. First and foremost, if you go to this help drop-down menu, you can see so many. There's documentation, there are examples, then there is support from the website itself. And first place you need to refer to any help that you need is the documentation. So documentation looks something like this. So this is how you get started with MATLAB. So you can see there on the side, you can see links to online trainings that are useful for people who are getting started with MATLAB. Then there are a lot of tutorials. And in this examples tab, if you go, you can see a number of examples you can explore on MATLAB online. Now, second aspect is there are a number of courses that are free, that are freely available for all of you at SPCE. So getting started, there are on-ramp courses. All these on-ramp courses are introductory courses. So we have MATLAB on-ramp. We have control design on-ramp. If you're using image processing, we have image processing on-ramp and so on. And there are focused foundational courses. So if you want to learn a lot more about MATLAB, you can go to MATLAB Fundamentals. If you want to learn about data processing and visualization, you can go for MATLAB for data processing and visualization. These are fairly large courses and they do take considerable amount of time. So, and they're all self-paced. So you can start a course anytime and you can end it anytime. You can pick it up again, resume from where you left off. And you can eventually also get a certificate, a course completion certificate that you can share on LinkedIn and other social media platforms. There are a number of computational mathematics courses that might be useful for all the students here. Please pay attention. You might have taken courses in linear algebra, ODEs, or nonlinear equations. All those, there are some short mathematics courses that will teach you how to use MATLAB for solving mathematical problems. The next aspect, there is this online community, very active online community that is sharing resources. There are a lot of resources that are developed by faculty abroad who have put out their content for use. For other people. So there are a number of live scripts, there are some apps and so on. So please explore our online teaching page where you can find these a lot of resources for you to use and explore and use it in your own teaching. And the fourth aspect is our team, myself and Anand. We both come from this team known as Customer Success Engineering team. And we do support a lot of faculty members who want to use MATLAB. We can build apps, we can design content, we can work with you to help you use MATLAB in your courses, research, and so on. So you can reach out to us. We can also provide help. We already saw this, a number of self-paced courses, then community resources, and so on. So that brings us to the end of our session today. I hope you all enjoyed and got some flavor of what MathWorks MATLAB looks like. So if you have any questions, you can put it in the chat here, or you can drop me an email. We can take it forward, but we request you to fill in the feedback form. The link will be shared in the chat. If you enjoyed this session, please fill in the feedback form, and we can improve our content based on your feedback. I think there are two feedback forms that are going on. One is from the institute itself, and there's one more from us. So do fill in both of the feedback forms.
Thank you for the wonderful session, ma'am. Dear participants, kindly fill the feedback form posted in the chat box. And I request our student Darshini to deliver the vote of thanks.
Thank you, ma'am. Good evening, all. I'm here to present the vote of thanks for today's webinar. I'd like to start by thanking our guest speaker, Ms. Vandana. Thank you, ma'am. The session was very informative and full of interesting facts. Particularly, the significance of MATLAB in civil engineering applications like graphic studies and structural dynamics was fascinating. Thank you again, ma'am, for taking the time and enlightening us with knowledge. I express my sincere thanks to our management, principal, and head of the department, Dr. R. Kumura, and our faculty members for organizing this lecture session. Also, I would like to extend my gratitude to all the students for being here and paying attention. Thank you all.
Thank you very much, Darshini.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you, Darshini. Thank you, ma'am. So I thank all the participants, and the session is over. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. I hope you've been able to learn something in today's session. Do feel free to reach out to us, and we'll be happy to support you. The faculty members